Good morning. I want to welcome you to worship on this fifth Sunday after the Epiphany. Thank you for being here. Let's see. So, a couple of announcements. We'll get the boring ones out of the way first. The front office has been working very hard, Rhonda, and if you haven't heard, her backup is a woman named Linda. They worked very hard this week to get the contribution statements out. So there's a box in the back. I think it's back there by the candy to go along with your tax filing this year. So please pick those up on your way out. Let's see. So everyone who served on council in 2023, committee chairs, we need your annual report. Okay. The annual reports will go in our yearbook. We'd like to get those out soon, so we're looking for getting those reports in ASAP. We'd like to publish the yearbook by the 1st of March. All right, I have a note here about Thrivent. As you know, Thrivent is very supportive of a lot of the things we do around. Throughout the year, we use what are called action teams, which are these micro grants, $250 grants that they give us a little debit card and we can go spend that $250 to help us with other things. But once a year, there's something called choice dollars, which is totally separate. If you are a Thrivent customer, you have access to these choice dollars. These are dollars, comes out of the company's profits, I think. And as their customer, you can tell them, I want my choice dollars to go to wherever. If you do not tell Thrivent where your choice dollars are going, Thrivent will put them where they pick. So that money is going somewhere. If you are a member of our church family, we'd like to think you would have it go here. It can be designated to go to a church. But if you don't tell the company, they will decide where it goes and it won't be here. Okay? So I would encourage you, if you're a Thrivent customer, please speak with your agent and ask them how to make that happen. Let's see. Teresa, anything else I need to say about that? Does that cover it? Oh, thank you. Yeah, it has to be done by the end of March. Yeah. End of March is the deadline.
You can actually do it online.
Okay. You can do it online through your online account access?
Yes.
Okay. Or on the phone? Okay. All right. Our Monday night Bible study has finished our series on the case for Christ. So we're going to take tomorrow night off. Next Monday then will be council, and we'll resume with the Bible study on February the 19th. And what the group picked this time is we're gonna study a book by the German Lutheran pastor Dietrich Bonhoeffer. You've heard me say that name, I hope, in several sermons. He, brilliant man, had some incredibly spiritual insight about a lot of things. So the book we're going to study is called Life Together. Lori, how much did you pay for your copy? It was like $5, $6?
$8.
Okay, so it's not bad. You can get a used copy, get one with highlights in it, whatever, but this is the book we're going to be going through, and it's probably going to take us a few months. Bonhoeffer can be, he can really make you think, so we're not going to plow through it fast. We're going to take it slow and absorb as much of it as we can. So this book is about what it means to be a community of Christians living together and what God intends that to look like. So, okay. All right, so as it is the first Sunday in February, we have a couple things we need to recognize. Let's start with wedding anniversaries. If your wedding anniversary is celebrated in the month of February, please raise your hand. I remember this from the newsletter being a very short list, so who are you pointing at? Oh, okay. All right, I don't think they're here, but for anyone in our church family who celebrates an anniversary this month, happy anniversary. Now, birthdays. I know there's a couple. One that I have been asked to make sure is mentioned is Shauna Deaton's birthday was yesterday. She's been trying to hide it, so make sure you wish her a happy birthday when you see her. But today we have a birthday, and it's a significant one. Am I allowed to say it? I'll just say this. It ends in a zero, so it's a significant one. So your first anniversary of your 59th year. from the birthday girl herself, Lori Wilcox. Today is her birthday. Who else has a birthday in February? Raise your hands. Eric Ecker, Jonathan, Rick, when's yours? End of the month. Okay. All right, keep those hands up. Oh, Lindsay, your birthday's, it was Friday? Nice, nice. Reese has a birthday this month, doesn't she?
Reese's is today.
Is that today too? Awesome. Excellent. Who else am I missing? Did I see anything? All right. Wayne, would you lead us?
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, brothers and sisters. Happy birthday to you.
Excellent. Excellent. Connie. Oh, I'm sorry, Connie. I didn't see your hand back there. Happy birthday to you as well. Okay, please do check out the rest of the announcements in the bulletin. The Stewardship Committee has a meeting coming up on the 7th. This Friday will be because we're still in the dark season with short daylight hours, the Friday Fellowship group will be meeting at Olive Garden for lunch at 1 p.m. So as always, if you'd like to attend, please just contact Alice Kirby by Thursday so she can make the arrangements. Let's see. And of course, since we're in February, Fat Tuesday's coming up. That'll be not this Tuesday, but the following Tuesday. So the youth are going to treat us to pancakes and I think bacon. Yep, bacon. And any donations you would make as you come to that dinner will go towards the events coming up on the youth calendar. So looking to have a very active year with our youth, so I hope you'll support them. On the 18th, we will have bingo. Now, we used to do this. We did this before that pandemic thing hit us, and we're going to rekindle that activity. So now, it's going to be just a little bit tricky because it's also the first Sunday in Lent, which means we have an evening Lent service. So we'll leave the bingo schedule unchanged, and we're just going to slide that evening's Lenten service from 5 to 5:30. So we'll start a little later so that we can do both. But we want to make sure this one is, that we're able to enjoy that one. So, all right. And I do want to highlight again, March 2nd. If you can, join us out at the Lake House. We're going to have a lunch out there. And we just want to kind of share some memories before we burn down that house. It's provided many people in this church family with a lot of good memories. And this is the beginning of the next chapter in how we as stewards of this gift use it for God's kingdom and God's purposes. So I hope you can join us for that. And lunch is just going to be simple. It'll just be burgers and dogs, but I hope you can come out there because it's more about the fellowship and the memories than anything else. I'm sorry? It's on the calendar in the February newsletter, but I think we set it for noon, if I remember correctly. But whatever the time, I'm going from memory here, so whatever the time on the calendar is, that's the time we'll be there. I'm pretty sure we set noon, though.
Yes.
12. Thank you, Sean. Okay. That's all the announcements I have on my list. Are there any other announcements for, yes, sir? Thank you, yeah. If you didn't hear Sean, February 10th, which is this coming Saturday, is the deadline we've set for getting anything that's in the lake house that we want to preserve to get it out. Tables and chairs, Bibles, games, that kind of stuff. So if you think there might be anything in the lake house that you might have left there that you want to preserve, you have 6 days to get it. And then we're going to give the rest to the fire department. They need to have a lived-in house for their training. And everything that's left in there will be burned. So, all right, ma'am.
The flowers on the altar were given by Dolan and Diane today, and that just got missed accidentally.
Thank you. I'm sorry. Thank you.
Dolan and Diane. Thank you.
Yes. Thank you for that. And the other vase here, I think, is for Lori. Is it?
Yeah.
Am I right? So, So the birthday girl got her own vase. Excellent. All right. Seeing no other announcements or indications thereof, please take a quiet moment and prepare your hearts and minds for worship. Begin with a brief order for confession and forgiveness on page 56. I invite you to stand as you are able. We begin this morning in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Please take a moment to reflect on your personal sins as we lay them at the foot of the cross. Most merciful God, we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us. Renew us and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our entrance hymn is number 390. I love to tell the story.
Oh,
grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Stand watch over your family, O Lord, that we who depend entirely on your heavenly grace may always be protected in the mighty fortress of your love. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated. I'd like to invite the children up for the children's message.
Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong, they are weak, but he is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so.
Good morning. How are you doing? Yeah, did you have a good week? Now, I know this is going to be a test, and I'm sorry, I don't mean it to be a test, but I'm going to ask anyway. Do you remember last week's children's message? You remember I asked Layla to describe somebody to me? Lila. Jesus. We got one of each, and I keep, sorry. Anyway, I sat like this, right? I sat here, and I didn't look, and Lila described somebody to me, and I said, I don't really know who that is. Right? So when you don't know who somebody is and you don't know anything about them, how do you get to know them? Do you remember? You got to spend time with them, right? You got to talk to them. So if you want to get to know God, what do you need to do? Right. How do you do that? By being with him? Okay. How do you be with God? How do you be with God? You pray, right? What's another way? What do you think, Graylin? What's another way to be with God? Read the Bible. There you go. Read the Bible and pray, okay? Now, you can read. Michael, can you read yet? You can read. Some, right? Can you read yet, Mason? You're still learning, right? Right? Can you read yet? Not yet, but you're learning your ABCs and stuff, right? So you'll get there. Now, two of you can read and two of you can't. Can you pray? Can you? Can you pray? Right? You can. Can you pray? Of course you can. Can you pray, Graylin? What do you pray for?
I pray for the Lord, the Jesus, and Holy Spirit.
Right.
Son, Father.
Right. Okay. So that's who you're praying to. But what? So let me ask it this way. What kinds of things can you pray for?
Jesus.
Mm-hmm. You can pray for Jesus. What? But when you pray for, can you pray for your family?
Yeah.
Okay. For what? For the food that he's given us, right? Do you say a prayer when you eat? When you sit down to eat a meal? Yeah? What do we call that? You can get better at that. We can all get better at that. We call that saying grace, right? Right? We ask God to bless our food. Okay. What else can we pray for? Right? Can you pray for somebody who's sick? Yeah, we really need to do that, don't we? Can you pray for, like, let's say you drive past an ambulance with its lights on. What does an ambulance with its lights on mean? Somebody probably got hurt, right? Or somebody's really sick. Can you pray for those people? Even if you don't know their names? Well, sure, because who does know their names? God does. Do you think praying is important? Yeah, it really is. You know, one of the ways we know that praying is important? Because even Jesus prayed. Think about that. Jesus is God's son, right? Does he know the Father pretty well? Yeah, he really does. And he still prays to the Heavenly Father. If Jesus prays to the Heavenly Father, do you think it's important that we pray too? Very much. What? Joseph was Jesus' earthly father, but he's the Son of God. So he has a heavenly father just like we do, right? Okay? But that's a good point, Graylin. So we have to remember, how often do you think we should pray? A lot? That's a good answer. A lot. How often do you think we should pray, Mason? A lot. Do you think we should pray once a week? Yeah. How about once a day? How about a couple times a day? Is that too much? Probably not. Do you pray before you go to bed at night? Yeah. At least sometimes, right? It would be good to thank God for your day. Do you think it'd be good to pray when you get up? God, help me have a good day. Amen. Is that a prayer? Yeah. That's all you have to do. Just talk to him. Do you think God wants to hear from you? Yes, he does. He wants you to spend time with him. He wants to hear from you. He wants to know that you want to share with him. Right? Does he know everything that's going on in your life?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. What he wants is he wants you to share it with him. Okay? It's important to ask for things that you want. It's also important to give thanks for the things that you have. Right? Okay? Those are different ways to pray. And if you give thanks for what you have and you ask for things that you want, especially for other people that, like, they might feel better, or that they might do well in school or whatever. If you ask God to help other people with things, that will really make a difference. It will help you to grow closer to God, and it will benefit that other person too. Okay? Praying is important. Pray every day. Okay? Should we try that right now? Let's pray right now. Make your prayer hands, close your eyes. Dear God, thank you that you love us so much. Thank you that you've promised to always hear our prayers. Help us to bring more of ourselves to you in prayer. Help us to spend more time with you, and help us to grow closer to you. And we pray this in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. All right. I think Madison has some busy bags for you.
The first reading for this fifth Sunday after Epiphany comes from the 40th chapter of Isaiah. Do you not know? Do you not hear? Has it not been told you from the beginning? Have you not understood from the foundations of the earth? It is he who sits above the circle of the earth, and its inhabitants are like grasshoppers, who stretches out the heavens like a curtain and spreads them like a tent to dwell in, who brings princes to nothing and makes the rulers of the earth as emptiness. Scarcely are they planted, scarcely sown, scarcely has their stem taken root in the earth, when he blows on them and they wither, and the tempest carries them off like stubble. To whom then will you compare me, that I should be like him, says the Holy One? Lift up your eyes on high and see who created these. He who brings out their host by number, calling them all by name, by the greatness of his might, and because he is strong in power, not one is missing. Why do you say, O Jacob, and speak, O Israel? My way is hidden from the Lord, and my right is disregarded by my God. Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint, and to him who has no might, he increases strength. Even youth shall faint and be weary, and young men shall fall exhausted. But they who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We will now sing responsively Psalm 147.
Hallelujah, how good it is to sing praises to our God. How pleasant it is to honor him with praise.
The Lord rebuilds Jerusalem. He gathers the exiles of Israel.
He heals the brokenhearted and binds up their wounds.
He counts the number of the stars and calls them all by their names.
Great is our Lord and mighty in power. There is no limit to his wisdom.
The Lord lifts up the lowly, but casts the wicked to the ground.
Sing to the Lord with thanksgiving. Make music to our God upon the
second reading is from 1 Corinthians, the 9th chapter. For if I preach the gospel, that gives me no ground for boasting, for necessity is laid upon me. Woe to me if I do not preach the gospel, for if I do this of my own will, I have a reward, but it is not of my own will. I am still entrusted with the stewardship. What then is my reward? That in my preaching I may present the gospel free of charge, so as not to make full use of my right in the gospel? For though I am free for all, I have made myself a servant to all, that I might win more of them. To the Jews, I became as a Jew in order to win Jews. To those under the law, I became as one under the law, though not being myself under the law, that I might win those under the law. To those outside the law, I became as one outside the law, not being outside the law of God, but under the law of Christ, that I might win those outside the law. To the weak, I became weak, that I might win the weak. I have become all things to all people, that by all means I might save some. I do it all for the sake of the gospel, that I may share with them in its blessings. Do you not know that in a race all the runners run, but only one receives the prize? So run that you may obtain it. Every athlete exercises self-control in all things. They do it to receive a perishable wreath, but we an imperishable. So I do not run aimlessly. I do not box as one beating the air, but I discipline my body and keep it under control, lest after preaching to others, I myself should be disqualified. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the first chapter. Immediately, Jesus left the synagogue and entered the house of Simon and Andrew with James and John. Now Simon's mother-in-law lay ill with a fever, and immediately they told him about her. And he came and took her by the hand and lifted her up, and the fever left her, and she began to serve them. That evening at sundown, they brought to him all who were sick or oppressed by demons. And the whole city was gathered together at the door. And he healed many who were sick with various diseases and cast out many demons. And he would not permit the demons to speak because they knew him. And rising very early in the morning, while it was still dark, he departed and went out to a desolate place. And there he prayed. And Simon and those who were with him searched for him. And they found him and said to him, "Everyone is looking for you." And he said to them, "Let us go on to the next towns, that I may preach there also, for that is why I came out." And he went throughout all Galilee, preaching in their synagogues and casting out demons. The Gospel of the Lord. Please be seated. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Brothers and sisters in Christ, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Okay, so our season after the Epiphany is coming to a close. Only one more Sunday left before Lent begins. The Christ has been revealed to the world in a variety of ways so far in this season. To the Gentile wise men from the East, to John the Baptist followers by the voice of God himself, by a demon-possessed man in last week's reading. Today's gospel reading tells us that many, many demons were present as he healed the sick in Capernaum. But Jesus wouldn't let them speak because they knew him. So just like last week, I think there's a little bit of a conflict here. Seems to go against the theme of the season, right? Epiphany is about revealing the Christ, the Messiah, to the whole world. Mark tells us that Jesus did not let the demons speak. They would have spoken and revealed him to everyone present. Their knowledge of Jesus of Nazareth was 100% true. We know that from last week, right? It's noteworthy, at least somewhat, that Capernaum has many demons troubling its citizens. Mark wants us to know that this is a large number and that Jesus dealt with all of them. He did a lot of exorcisms. Now, it seems clear that Jesus silenced all of them, because if he hadn't, they would have shouted out their knowledge of his godhood, his deity, and his messiahship, as one scholar puts it. Last week, Jesus dealt with this same thing. The demon shouts out in synagogue, "I know who you are, the Holy One of God." The demon reveals this openly because he knows Jesus doesn't want it made public yet. Jesus wants people to discover who he is through his words, through his deeds. Jesus never proclaimed that he was the Messiah. He never said that he was the Son of God. At least he didn't initiate that thought, okay? He let people draw this conclusion on their own. And then when they came to that conclusion, whether they believed it or not, he would then reinforce it. The demons know they can't beat Jesus, so they seek to disrupt his plans and throw off his timing by revealing him earlier than he wanted them to. Of course, even without the demons speaking out, Jesus is growing in fame. That's what we're told in the last verse from last week's reading. At once, his fame spread everywhere throughout all the surrounding region of Galilee. People got to know who this guy was. He then goes to Peter's house, which is mere yards from the synagogue. I hope you remember me describing that last week. And it appears he just wants some time with his friends, right? And he then performs another very simple act of healing. He doesn't make a big show of it. He doesn't even say anything, at least not as Mark tells it. He simply takes her by the hand and helps her stand up from the bed. Very simple. Without ever a word, she then begins to serve everyone there. Now, let's pause right here for just a minute. If you think about this situation, it seems obvious. Here's Peter's mother-in-law who's living with Peter and his wife, right? So she must be a widow. We can draw that conclusion, I think. And she must have no other children, or her own son would have taken her in. That's the way society worked. Peter's a good man, so he brings his wife's mother under his care. Now, even though it's Peter's house, I can see the grandmother type with guests in the house wanting to make sure everyone was fed. We all know the type, right? Some of you are sitting in the pews right now. Oh, we need to feed these people. All the gospel writers who describe this scene give us the understanding that this woman didn't have just a mild fever. This was a serious illness. And since they didn't have modern medicine like we do, fevers, you know, give them some Tylenol, knock it out, they'll come around in a day or two. Not this time. She was likely going to die from this illness, okay? Jesus just takes her hand and lifts her up. And she then heads where? Straight for the kitchen, right? Can you picture this? She wants to make sure they're properly served. And if you're a fan of the series The Chosen, I think the way they portray this scene is perfect. But there is a lesson that we need to take from this, and it wasn't readily apparent to me until I got some scholarly clarity earlier this week. Jesus heals so that we may serve. That's exactly what happened here, right? The healing ministry of Jesus restores ordinary human lives of service. The people he touches are not freed from their human responsibilities. They are not freed from their other relationships. On the contrary, Jesus' touch removes everything which damages or obstructs our human lives of service. That's why he heals us. I might even add that his touch restores things that we often take for granted, things we might otherwise think of as unremarkable. Now, this scene where he heals Peter's mother-in-law is a very private act. It's done in the confines of his friend's home, behind closed doors. But the crowds found him anyway, didn't they? They located him, and they gathered in front of the house in large numbers. Now, Mark mentioned sundown, right? It didn't happen until sundown. Why? To show that they honored the Sabbath law. Carrying a relative is considered work. So that they wouldn't violate the Sabbath law of rest, they waited until the day was over. So how many showed up? Mark tells us, the whole city. The whole city. What would it take for all of Hickory to show up at one place? Well, that's what happened here. Now, historians estimate the whole city of Capernaum was about 1,500 people. Many of those 1,500 were ill or demon-possessed. We don't have an exact number, but suffice it to say, the way Mark tells it, Jesus had a pretty big task in front of him. And from the way we're told, Jesus must have healed every single one of them. Everyone who was brought to Peter's door. Jesus wouldn't like pick and choose. He would have healed all of them. So it must have been a long and busy night for this man from Nazareth. And then well before dawn, Mark tells us, Jesus goes off to a desolate place, a quiet place, a lonely place. Why? So that he can pray. We have a significant number of times recorded in the Gospels when Jesus prays. It's a long list. Every time this act of prayer by the Son of God is recorded, it concerns something very important in his ministry. We learn very quickly in this passage that this time when he prays, it is about his resolve to preach the gospel of the kingdom throughout Galilee. Not to heal, to preach the gospel. That's his focus. That's his primary mission. Jesus prayed because he was a man. His prayers were communions with his Father. The Son had become man, and as such, he was dependent on his Father in all things. So he prayed. He prayed about this. And then, what did he do after that? He told his followers about his love and his perfect obedience to his Father. Once again, setting for us the perfect example. When Peter and the others found him, it was clear that the people must have been impressed by Jesus' acts of healing. Everyone is looking for you. Well, yeah, of course they are, right? If the whole town gathered the night before with their sick and their demon-possessed and Jesus healed all of them, what did they expect him to do next? What did they want from him if all the sick and demon-possessed have been healed? Interestingly, Jesus did not think these acts of healing were the reason he was there. He was there to preach. He was there to spread the gospel. The healing was just on the side. Let us go on to the next towns that I may preach there also, for that is why I came out, he says. He came to preach the gospel far and wide, not to stay in one place. Remember, Jesus had a home in Capernaum. To this day, it says, the city of Jesus. He hadn't gone very far at all yet. His mission had just started. This is still Mark chapter 1. Not that long since the temptation. He was not meant to stay safely at home. He had already now given the people in his own town both the gospel message he was sent to give them and the healing and the deliverance that they needed and wanted. And since they were seeking him, it was clear they were hungry for more. I think Jesus meant that his disciples could work to feed that hunger after he was gone. They were seeking the right things. I think also there are two things we can learn from the last couple of verses. First is that we too are not called to stay safely in our place. Our calling is to share this gospel message with the world around us, especially to those who have not heard it. And I know I've said this before, and I'll say it again. It baffles me that there are people in the United States that have not heard this message. But believe me when I tell you, they're out there. And the numbers of people who have not heard who Jesus Christ is growing. The only way they'll hear it is if we share it with them. This is the work to which we have been sent. We, like Christ, are called to come out of our place. I know you probably have gotten to the point where it's not something you're looking at anymore, but on the back of your bulletin are three vision points. Vision point number 2, grow in our outreach, in our visibility to the surrounding community, in our connections with our neighbors and our community. If we're going to grow in our outreach, we have to reach out. We have to go beyond these walls. The other thing I think we can learn from Jesus here is to follow his example of prayer. If the Son of God himself, who already knows the Heavenly Father better than any other human being, even the most holy among us, if he can spend time in prayer with the Father, then we should take that as our example to follow. If we want to get to know God better, as I've spent telling the kids the last 2 weeks in a row, if we want to get to know him better, we have to spend more time with him. Prayer, I think, is one of the best ways to do that. Now, I'm going to tell you, in seminary, they don't teach us how to pray. I think they expect that by the time you're an adult, you know how to pray. I'm going to guess that I am not the only person who got to the age of 40 and thought, I really don't know how to pray very well. No one really coaches us on this in the Lutheran denomination. I think this is one of our failings as Lutherans. So I'm going to offer a couple of things that I've found this week that I think might be helpful. Here's a definition of prayer that I really like, that I did not ever hear until this week. Prayer is surrender. Surrender to the will of God and then cooperation with his will. If I throw out a boat hook from my boat and catch hold of the shore and I pull, do I pull the shore to me or do I pull myself to the shore? Prayer is not pulling God to my will, but the aligning of my will to the will of God. If you remember nothing else from this long, boring sermon, I hope you remember that illustration. You do not pull yourself, you do not pull the shore to yourself, you pull yourself to the shore. Martin Luther had quite a bit to say about prayer. I'll pull out one of his shortest. Pray as if everything depends on God, and then work as if everything depends on you. I like that one a lot. This might be my favorite quote, though. Have you heard of the book Pilgrim's Progress? If you haven't, I encourage you to look it up. Its author's name is John Bunyan, and he said this: "You can do more than pray after you've prayed, but you cannot do more than pray until you have prayed." Brothers and sisters, the year in front of us has a great deal of potential for us in a bunch of different ways, and I mean a bunch. Let me pick 2. The lake property and the election season. Both of those things are bound to have a significant impact on the life of this church, in my humble opinion. Do you think then that it is important that we pray about those things? I certainly do. I think we should, each one of us, individually, pray about these things as Christians, individually, as households, and as a congregation. Now, I'll work on the congregation part. My ask to you is that you handle the individual part and the household part, okay? If you don't know how to pray about these things, let me offer a couple of tips. This is from William Barclay. He says, when we pray, remember, one, the love of God that wants the best for us, two, the wisdom of God that knows what is best for us, and three, the power of God that can accomplish that. So keep that in mind when you pray. The love of God that wants the best for us, the wisdom that knows what that is, and the power to do it. Okay? Now there are many, many more things than just these two things that I mentioned facing our church family that deserve our prayers. And if you know what those are, add them to your prayers. I would also suggest share it with the church office so then we can share it with the church family. If you're not sure that prayer works, I'm here to tell you there are plenty of people here in our church family who have experienced firsthand the power of prayer. Just ask. You probably know who I'm talking about. And it's not just one or two. There are several of you, just in the time that I have been your pastor, that have experienced this. And if you are one of those people, I encourage you to share your witness. I haven't said this in a while, and it's too long. But that doesn't mean I haven't been thinking it, so let me say it out loud again. God is doing good things in this congregation. God is doing good things in this congregation. Now, of course, we can never earn God's favor. I hope you've never heard me say that, because that's not true. We can't earn God's favor. But we can reduce, I think, the obstacles that might get in the way of Him blessing us. Does that make sense to you? I think prayer is one of the best tools we have to reduce those obstacles. I think prayer is one of the best ways that we can open our line of communication to God when it might otherwise be clogged. It might even be our best tool. So if you are not one who prays frequently, I would ask you to start. I would ask you to start. Pray for things going on in our church family, and if you're not already, pray for our country. If you think about it, of the two number one candidates in the presidential election coming up, no matter who wins, there's going to be violence. And that scares me. We need to pray for our country. We need to be in prayer for our country constantly. Locally, we need to be in prayer for our church. We need to be in prayer for our community. What can we be doing to help our community in addition to praying for it? That was the thrust of our drive-through prayer ministry that we had been doing, that I hope to rekindle. And if you're not already, let me ask you, please pray for me. I covet your prayers. I need your prayers. If you are not praying for me, please do so. You cannot pray for me too much. Let's put that tool to good use, please. Let's put that tool of prayer into our lives frequently to ask for God's guidance in the work that's in front of us, the work with the Lake House, the work with our committees and our council, the things that we want to do in God's kingdom as His representatives to the people who don't know Him. Let's pray that He will use us in this work, that we will help to reveal His Son to the world. Because I'm here to tell you, the world desperately, desperately needs Jesus Christ. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Please stand as you are able. God has made us his people through our baptism into Christ. Living together in trust and hope, we confess our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is, seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Now let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs.
Tender Lord of mercy, you know our deepest thoughts and fears that sometimes get in the way of spending time with you. Help us to remember that you alone can sustain us through whatever we are facing. Help us remember that it is through our times of trial where we can learn to trust you and be a witness to your healing power. We pray that the church would be a beacon of hope to the world with all its concerns. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Gracious Father, we don't always seek you first in times of gratitude, trouble, or counsel. We ask today that we would be ever mindful that you are always here for us. We also pray for those who don't know you. May we be a light of hope to them through our prayers, words, and deeds. We ask that you would pour out your Holy Spirit upon us, that we may know what we are to pray at all times and in all situations. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Heavenly Father, we know that there are countless people who live among us that feel lonely or uncared for in this world. We pray, as your church, that we would intentionally work to find them through our ministries. Let us be your hands and feet in the world to serve others as you would have us do. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Father God, we pray for those who are sick, hospitalized, preparing for surgery, are suffering in any way. We pray especially for everyone on our prayer list, those we name now in our hearts, those known only to you, that they would be consoled and strengthened to endure through their faith in Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. We pray for their loved ones, that they find comfort through you. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, Heavenly Father, help us consistently care for the leaders and pastors of our church, particularly Bishop Dan and his staff, Dean Nathan, Pastor Todd, Pastor Nelson, Pastor Henry, Vicar Rebecca, and all clergy in the Carolinas Mission Region. May we continue to lift them up in prayer for their own well-being and for the well-being of the whole church. We thank you for their presence in the church and in the world as beacons of light and hope to a people in need of your peace, presence, and strength. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Merciful Lord, be with our brothers and sisters whose congregations are discerning the call for a new pastor, especially Mount Calvary and Grace Lutheran Churches. Assure them of your Holy Spirit's presence through the call process, and guide us to be good neighbors to them during this transition. Bless their interim pastors as they lead them through this season of change. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your abundant mercy. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Please share that peace with your neighbor. Maker of all things, Through your goodness, you have blessed us with these gifts. With them, we offer ourselves to your service and dedicate our lives to the care and redemption of all that you have made. For the sake of him who gave himself for us, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give you thanks and praise.
It is indeed right and salutary that we should at all times and in all places offer thanks and praise to you, O Lord, Holy Father, through Christ our Lord. Sharing our life, he lived among us to reveal your glory and love, that our darkness should give way to his own brilliant light. And so with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Blessed are you, Lord of heaven and earth. In mercy for our fallen world, you gave your only Son, that all those who believe in him should not perish, but have eternal life. We give thanks to you for the salvation you have prepared for us through Jesus Christ. Send now your Holy Spirit into our hearts, that we may receive our Lord with a living faith as he comes to us in his Holy Supper. Amen.
Come, Lord Jesus.
In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this for the remembrance of me." Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Come, for all is now ready. The gifts of God for the people of God.
Have mercy on us.
Lamb of God, you take away the sin.
invite you to stand as you are able. Pardon me. Body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen.
Thank the Lord and sing his praise.
Let us pray. Almighty God, you gave your Son both as a sacrifice for sin and a model of the godly life. Enable us to receive him always with thanksgiving and to conform our lives to his. Through the same Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.
Amen.
Our closing hymn is Praise to the Lord, number 543.